The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Sounds in the world today is the ring of the telephone. It produces a predictable reflex action. The phone rings, you pick it up. It's only too human to want to know who's on the other end. The impulse always is to answer, an impulse you should never have succumbed to if your name had been Betsy Grant.
I don't mean to stick my nose in your business, lady, but it looks like someone is tailing you.
Me? Where?
The little brown foreign job, two cars back.
Oh.
Want I should lose him?
Yes. Please, cab driver, please. Oh, if you possibly can, please. Lose him.
Our mystery drama, The Sound of Terror, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Patricia Elliott. It is sponsored in part by True Value Hardware Stores. I'll be back shortly with Act One. It was the sergeant of police in Gilbert and Sullivan's Pirates of Penzance who sang the sad complaint, "A policeman's lot is not an happy one." Watching Detective Sergeant Ed Ritter and his girlfriend Betsy Grant as they snake along in weekend traffic after a day at the beach, it would be hard to agree with Gilbert's line. This is one happy policeman, relaxed and obviously very much in love. And so is Betsy, her eyes locked on his strong young face as he talks while he drives.
Oh, boy, what a day. You know, in spite of all the traffic, I feel great. How about you, Ben?
Ed, honey, I'm so relaxed. I don't know if I'm asleep or awake.
Well, I'd better get you straight home if you're that tired.
Oh, I'm not tired. Just full of sun, salt, and sea air. And happiness. And love. In a world of my own. Our own. The other one doesn't even exist.
Uh-oh. I'm sorry you brought that up.
What?
The other world. I mean this one. I gotta check in, see what's going on.
And the commissioner himself has ordered all leaves canceled. All off-duty personnel to report as soon as possible. That is all personnel. Uniform or plainclothes. Now, this announcement will be repeated shortly. At the moment, we have a 10-4-0 at Blyer and Spain Streets. Cars 103, 216, and 180 are ordered there. Please contact Central and each other and coordinate. Repeat, there is a 10-4-0 at Blyer and Spain.
What is it, Ed?
The 10-4-0.
No, I know what that is. Disturbance of the peace. What's the other?
Search me, hon. I'll tell you something, though. It's something big if the commissioner is sticking his nose in.
You better call in.
Yeah, I know. It's just what I'm doing.
Shouldn't you pull over and park?
What, in this traffic? I'm practically parked already.
On the 8th Precinct, Captain Reimer.
Jerry, it's Ed Ritter. Just came out of the Midtown Tunnel after a day at the beach. I was feeling great till I cut in the squawk box. What hit the fan?
Oh, the West Arabian ambassador to the UN went and got himself abducted. Now, look, boy, you better get down here as fast as you can.
Well, look, I got Betsy with me. I'm stuck in traffic. It'll take me half to three-quarters of an hour to run a home.
Honey, boy, maybe you're not reading me. I want you here 5 minutes ago. Now, you drop your gun and let her take a cab or a bus and get down here yesterday. That is an order.
Okay, Jerry. I read you.
Now what, Ed?
Ma'am, got to report in immediately. Honey, it looks like you're going to have to grab a cab home. I'll give you some money.
Oh, I don't need a cab. Just drop me at 9th Avenue and I'll take a bus.
You will take a cab. I'm not taking any more chances with you than I have to.
Ed, I'm a big girl, a city girl. I can take care of myself. What got you so uptight?
I'm going to turn on the siren, honey. I got to move. Someone kidnapped the West Arabian ambassador to the U.N.
Oh, what's his name?
Who?
The ambassador.
Oh, I'm not sure. Mohammed Hassim or something, isn't it?
Well, something like that.
Why?
I don't know. It just seemed a thing to ask. Who do you suppose kidnapped him?
Search me, darling. Got a guess? I'd say some terrorist group.
We're not going to have that here.
Look, we've all been holding our breath it wouldn't start here the way it has in the rest of the world.
That couldn't happen to us.
Oh, really? Why not? I can think of a heck of a lot of ways we're so much more careless than other countries. Well, listen, that isn't anything for you to worry about, Bessie. All I care about is that you take care of yourself.
Oh, you don't have to worry about me, Ed.
That's what I like to do best. You're my girl.
All the way. You know that.
You know, I don't know what we're waiting for to get married.
Family. Your folks, my folks, they all want to be a part of
it. Well, couldn't they wait till after?
Let's take care of the family first. After is for us.
Okay, baby. Hey, come on, I gotta move. Hey, kiss goodbye.
Uh-huh. Kiss forever.
I love you. But if I don't get you out and head for the precinct, I won't be able to afford to marry you.
Go on, Sergeant. Answer your bugle call.
Yeah. Now, listen, you go straight home. I want you to take a cab, not a bus.
All right. Whichever comes first. I'll wait by this covered bus stop, right by the phone booth. Oh, here's the bus. I've got to run.
Hey, I said a cab.
Why waste money? I didn't have to run too much. It was a 107. No good for me. When it pulled away, I was all alone at the bus stop. It was clouding up and looked like rain. But I was glad I had some shelter while I was waiting. There weren't any cabs available anyway. The traffic from the tunnel was thinning out, and it was starting to get dark. I don't know just at what point I found myself feeling lonely, but what made me realize it was when the phone started ringing. How do you feel when a phone rings and no one answers? I know how I do. Sure, I know it was a public phone, but it's sort of a reflex. Like the sixth ring, I couldn't help myself. I picked it up, and this voice said,
Ahmed, it is Kleber. They came through with the ransom. It is on its way to the pickup. Tonio is there. Now, do we pick it up even though Hassim is dead? Ahmed? Who is this? Ahmed? Ernest has our number.
What had I gotten myself into? Even in the act of hanging up, I'd seen a man in the building across the street on the second floor pull the shade up to stare at me and then rip it down as if to conceal his face. At the same moment, I spotted a cab and hailed it. I clambered in, desperately shouting my address, for the man was already on his way across the street. As the cab pulled away, I remembered that the phone started ringing again. My cab driver was in no hurry. I'm kind of late, driver. Could we speed it up?
What do you want? I should drive through a red light and get a ticket?
No, but as soon as you get the light, would you please hurry?
I don't like tickets.
Well, please make it as fast as you can. I looked back. The man had gone into the booth and was answering the phone. Just as the light changed and we began to move, he came running out and towards us. The light, it just changed.
I got eyes, lady. There's no sweat. These here lights are timed for 35 miles an hour all the way north. What's the rush?
I want to get home.
So do I. But I got a lot longer to sweat it out than you.
I looked back. The man had stopped, frustrated, under a streetlight. I could see his face clearly. I didn't like it then, and I would have reason to like it even less later. As
we pulled away, he ran back towards the cars parked along the curb. My hacky had the lights timed now and was bowling along smoothly. At 42nd, we ran into snags, and by the time we cleared traffic, the hacky was in communication again.
Hey, lady.
Yes?
I figured you earlier for just some nervous dame in a hurry, but you in trouble?
But what do you mean?
I don't mean to stick my nose in, but it kind of looks like somebody might be tailing you.
Where?
The little brown foreign job. You had two cars behind on the left. You recognize it?
I don't know.
You want I should lose it? Maybe just on general principle.
I can't see who's driving, but do you really think he's following
Listen,
me?
Listen, I drive a hack in New York. You learn a lot about human nature and all. The good and the bad. You know, you ask me a question, I give you an answer. From the experience I got rolled up, yeah.
I don't want him to follow me home.
I'll lose him for you.
He wasn't just a something, but a somebody. He really got into the whole thing like it was a game. Cutting lights, switching turns from right to left, doubling back and forth, until finally he drove me up to the brownstone where I had my apartment.
Hey, there you are, lady. 99A West 83. And all alone.
Here's the fare. And something extra for losing my follower.
Well, all in a day's or a night's work. I kind of got kicks from it, yeah. Hey, what are you? With the government or some kind of TV or movie star?
Neither. Nobody.
Oh, what was it? Your ex or something?
I beg pardon?
Your husband. Who was following you?
Oh, no. I don't even know that there was someone following you. It's just these days, a gal can't be too careful.
You got it. You want us to see in?
No. I'll be all right.
It's kind of gloomy down there in the basement.
Oh, that's just the front. In back, it's gorgeous.
Good night. Hey, watch your step.
I will. And thanks again for the help.
You can't do something for somebody every now and then. Watch life. Good night.
Stick. Oh, I'm coming. I'm coming. Hello?
It's me, hon. You just saved me heart failure. You get home all right?
Yes. Well, no, Ed. I've got to talk to you.
Well, any time but now, hon. I can't. This West Arabian ambassador thing is so big.
But that's what I want to talk to you about, Ed. Oh, this is the craziest coincidence, or whatever.
I can't stay on the phone. We're on a citywide alert.
But, Ed, what I have to tell you is something about that.
Well, okay, if you have anything, make it fast.
Okay, the bus I ran for, remember? It wasn't a 12, it was a 107. You know, that's the one that cuts across 57th to the east side. And
don't
goes
give me the bus routes, get to the point.
Okay, all right. So I didn't take that, but everyone else did. So I was alone, and while I was waiting for a bus or a cab, the phone rang.
The phone?
You know, there are a couple of public booths there.
Oh, yeah, all right, so what?
Well, you know how it is when a phone keeps ringing. A person feels they ought to answer.
You mean you answered a public phone that was ringing?
Well, yes, I did. I don't know why. It's hard to explain, but anyway, I picked up the receiver, and right away, there was a guy there saying that the money was ready to be picked up even though Hasim was dead, and there was this man who tried to follow me, only the taxi driver, a marvelous guy named Jake Brown, was able to lose him, and then it... Who are you? You're the man who followed me.
I did not even try to. You have a very clear voice. When you told the cab driver where you were going, I could hear it even across the street.
How did you get in here?
If you leave the keys in the door, who cannot follow? Come along. We must leave.
What do you mean? Leave?
Oh, my dear young lady, if you must involve yourself in international intrigue, you must take the consequences. And I am sorry to say, once you possess the wrong knowledge, the consequences obviously cannot be pleasant.
Knowledge is a dangerous thing, and it seems that inadvertently, Betsy Grant, responding to a very human and reasonable compulsion by the simple act of answering a telephone, has gained an amount of information that is dangerous. particularly to a man named Ahmed, who is responsible for many deaths in the past, a man who has nothing to lose by causing more of them in the future. I shall return shortly with Act Two. Answer telephone is so frustrating. There is another sound made by Alexander Graham Bell's invention that is even more frustrating. The busy signal, which has been caused by a sudden interruption in service. It can become unbearable. Worse than that, in the case of Detective Sergeant Ed Ritter, terrifying. For he knows intuitively that it was human intervention that broke the connection on his phone call to Betsy.
Ed, where are you? Come on, we're on assignment.
I'm trying to reach Betsy.
Well, I thought she called you.
Yeah, she did.
Well, so okay. I told you no long conversations. I'd be waiting in the car.
Jerry, everything's changed since then. I got a lead. I got to call Betsy back.
Call her back?
Well, what'd she do?
Hang up on you?
Here, listen.
Okay, so it's a busy signal. You can't hang around till she gets off the phone talking to her mother or some girlfriend.
No. It isn't like that, Jerry. But you see, Betsy was talking to me and someone broke the connection.
Ed, buddy, look, you're my best friend. I love you like a brother. But right now, we got no time for personal stuff. We got a big case to break.
This has to do with the case, Jerry. I told you I had a lead.
Well, for Betsy?
Yeah.
How?
Well, when I dropped her after you told me to get straight to the precinct, she was waiting for a bus, you see, and this phone began to ring.
What phone?
A coin phone right by the bus stop.
So?
So Betsy answered it.
What? She answered a public phone that was ringing? Was she expecting a call?
No, it was just... Well, you know, a phone rings, keeps ringing. If nobody else picks up, you do it.
Not me. What for?
Well, it's human nature. Someone maybe is in trouble, needs help. I don't know.
Okay. So she picks up the phone, and?
This voice on the other end starts right in and says, okay, the dough is ready to be picked up. Do they go ahead even if Hasim is dead or what?
Hey, wait a minute. Hasim? You sure she said Hasim?
Yeah.
That's the guy who was abducted.
Well, what do you think I'm trying to tell you?
Well, why are we wasting time talking? Get Betsy on the phone.
I can't. Don't you hear me? There's nothing but a busy signal.
Try her again.
No, Jerry. I'm not messing around anymore. Something's wrong. Now, I'm going over to Betsy's apartment and see for myself what.
All right, I'm going with you. Did she have any idea who the guy was that was calling?
Just that his name was Kleber. Oh, yeah, he called her by name, like the guy he expected to answer.
What name?
Ahmed.
Yeah, it's beginning to make a picture. This is no local caper. Hasim, Kleber, Ahmed, how international can you get? What do you figure is the sense in calling a public payphone?
Well, no chance of calls being traced or bugged. And normally that time of night, the area is deserted.
Yeah. The guy, Ahmed, was right across the street waiting for it to ring.
Probably on his way down when he saw Betsy answer. You figure they had it set up on a time schedule.
Yeah. You still think he could have followed you, Betsy, home?
No, she didn't think so.
But you do.
Look, Jerry, suppose she could recognize him. She saw him looking out the window. Now, what would the guy figure? This whole thing is big enough to take no chances. Yes, I think he must have tailed her, and I think that's why the phone got cut off, and I'm scared of what we could find when we get to her apartment.
All right, let's not jump to conclusions. Just keep her open wide the way you are, and let's get there fast. Which is her apartment?
Basement. Right behind the steps.
All right, hold up. Let's move easy. You cover me, I'll try the door.
Well, I'll take it, you cover.
No, sir, I'm saving you for Betsy. Cover me, that's an order. All right, we'll start legit. I'm ringing the doorbell. Police, open up, don't try anything, we're armed.
Oh, we're too late, huh? How's the door?
Locked. Stand back, it ain't the first door I kicked in. Watch it! Now just keep me covered.
Let me. I know where the lights are and things.
Okay, just take it easy.
The living room. I'm gonna get the light.
Stay low.
Yeah.
behind the couch.
Yeah, for sure.
Kitchen door's open. No one there. At the bedroom?
Yeah. Doesn't look like there'll be anyone there either.
Now take it easy, Ed.
You know, I can feel it in my bones. They got her. Look at the phone. It's off the hook. Here. This is her handbag. She never would have left that behind.
Let's look in the bedroom first before we jump to conclusions.
Hey, why? You don't think maybe...
Now, easy, Ed, easy. Come on. Where's the light switch?
I don't know. I guess...
Forget it. I found it. There's no problem here. All neat and tidy.
Yeah, let me make sure.
Under the bed. Closet.
Yeah.
Bathroom.
Well, at least they didn't total her. They must have taken her with them.
Where?
I don't know.
That should give you no notion about that?
No, none.
So it's up to us to find out. Let's get back to that phone.
Well, we've got to get out an APB.
Now, don't touch that phone again. There may be fingerprints.
So what are we going to do about Patsy?
Don't panic. We got a lot to work on. Hold it.
I got to answer it. It may be them about Patsy.
We'll answer it. You got a clean handkerchief?
Yeah.
Here, lend it to me.
Here you are.
Thank you. Huh? Oh, yes, George. This is Lieutenant Reimer. What's on your mind? Yeah? Yeah? Well, how do you read it? Okay, hold him. I want to question him myself. It doesn't look too hot, but you never can tell. Hmm? No, there's nothing to stand, except we're going to have to put out an APB on Ed Ritter's girlfriend. Yeah, it looks like she was snatched. You get this on the wires right away. Hold it a sec. Ed.
Yeah, what is it?
I'll fill you in on a kidnapping on our way back to the precinct. Right now, we need a description of Betsy to put out on the APB. I figure you can do that better than me.
I just hope we can find her.
Come on, cheer up, kid. They didn't get the money, so we have a bargaining point, even if Hasim is dead. Now, come on, take the phone. No, easy. Use the handkerchief.
Okay.
Might be fingerprints we can still use.
All right, Jimmy, I got it. This is Detective Sergeant Ritter with a rundown on a suspected abduction for Betsy of Elizabeth P. Adams, Caucasian, 24 years old. Eyes blue-gray, hair chestnut, height 5'4.5", weight 118. Identifying marks, one small mole on the left shoulder.
The drop for the ransom money was a wire trash can on 59th under the Queensborough Bridge. There's an open playground right there and very little cover to stake it out.
But it was staked out.
Sure. We had a young detective shooting a basketball on the playground and two other cops in a bar nearby with good sightlines to the drop. So when the guy came, they were all on him within a couple of minutes.
So you picked him up. Is he talking?
Is he talking? A blue streak.
And what does he say?
Nothing that's much help to us. His name is H. Harrison Trimble. He graduated from Harvard, 1936.
I don't care about his name. Has he given us any leads?
Oh, Ed, he's a derelict, a bum, a wino. He fell backwards into this, an accident.
Are you sure?
Well, I'm not sure of anything until I prove it out all the way. I just didn't want you to get your hopes up. No, I don't think Mr. Trimble is the answer. Tell you the truth, I think Mr. Trimble is the fly in the ointment. The accident that blew most of our chances.
What do you mean?
Well, the ransom was $3 million. It was deposited in the trash can in three plain brown paper bags. Now, Trimble resides in the shadow of the bridge. I mean, he chooses to make it his home rent-free. And he lives on other people's leavings. I don't suppose in all his years of poking through trash cans, he could even have dreamed ever of turning up $3 million. But when he did, his reflex was to take it on the land.
Yeah, but our boy stopped him.
That's right.
So, if that's the way it is, there's nothing he can tell us.
The way it looks, Ed.
So we're no nearer Betsy and Hasim than we were to start out with, huh?
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
What do you mean, Jerry?
Well, we know where your girlfriend answered the phone call. She looked across the street and she saw a guy who may or may not have had anything to do with all this. I've given orders to have that block checked out.
Why didn't I think of that first?
Maybe because you're still a sergeant and I'm a lieutenant. And she's not my girlfriend. I can be a little more objective.
got to get down there right away.
Easy, chum. It's being taken care of. They don't need us. And I'll level with you, Ed. I think it's too late. Those birds are too smart. They'll skip the coop. I think we'd better concentrate on Mr. Trimble and make sure he's what he seems to be.
All right, Clever. You have failed me. But first, we must get out of here fast.
Yeah, but what about the woman?
Your telephone correspondent. I have her under the influence of my own tranquilizers.
You didn't kill her like Hassim, not another accident.
Mohammed Hassim was no accident. I never intended him to live.
But the woman?
She is safe only as long as I may have need of her. You know, we must revise our plans. Come. There is no more time to waste.
Any more word, Ed?
No, not a thing. What about the bum?
Trimble. That's just what he is, a bum. I read him clean.
So, what do we do now?
How much do you love your Betsy?
That's a lousy question.
It's a lousy situation, Ed. Do you love her $3 million worth?
Oh, look, you can't put a price on something like that.
You can't. I'm stretching my neck out and putting a price. We're going to hear from these guys, Ed. With luck, they won't have changed the ransom. The money is still available.
Yeah, for an Arab named Hassim, who's already dead.
We don't know that for sure. And neither do the West Arabs. So, we take our chances. That $3 million may be too late to save the ambassador. But it may save you a girlfriend.
$3 million in cash floating loose. An Arabian UN ambassador who is dead or not dead. A girl who answered a telephone and inadvertently got herself embroiled in international terrorism. Where do we go from here? That, of course, must be saved up. Till I return shortly with Act 3. The telephone. How many of us stop to consider how large it looms in our life? Important it is. We have already explored emotional reactions to the various sounds it makes. Now we are examining its most devastating power, the power not to make any sound while we wait helpless, hoping against hope, for it to summon us to hear whatever news we need to survive, bad or good. This is the worst suspense, when it fails to ring at all.
I don't know if I can stand it much longer, Jerry.
Come on, we've both done army time. We know there's nothing harder than waiting.
You know, every time the phone rings, I want to jump and answer it.
Yeah, after the first few calls, you could lose that urge. People call the precinct about the craziest things.
But if Ahmed calls in...
Oh, that comes straight through to this phone here.
Why?
Because that's the contact Betsy will give him.
Yeah, if she's still alive.
Oh, now, why wouldn't she be... She could be the only bargaining point they have left.
Well, Clever, suppose you try to explain now what happened.
Everything was all set, Ahmed. The moment the money was put in the garbage can, the grapple hook was being sent down from the bridge. I could have been there and fastened it to the container to be lifted up and away before the police closed in. But that, that hobo was there before I could move.
You should have shot him.
I would have, but the police were too late.
I told you to reconnoiter before you moved.
I did, but the police were so well hidden.
But it was fortunate you didn't reveal yourself and us.
But now Hassim is dead, and the money is gone.
Gently, my friend. That Hassim is dead is a triumph for my brothers. He had to go. The money is something else again. We need it.
But we can't get it now. We have no leverage.
Because Hassim is dead?
Why did you kill him, Ahmed?
My dear friend, You must understand the intricacies of terrorism. Hasim was a pawn in a game of chess. To have to conceal and control him while the game was being played was, and always is, too difficult. He was only important as long as he affected the deal. Once that was made, he was dispensable.
But you didn't get the money. How do you get it now?
Through the girl. They know she is alive. And they cannot be sure that Hasim is dead. Hand me the newspaper.
There's nothing there we don't already know.
We can use the print for what already only we know. And the girl to tell us where to send it.
This just came in the mail for you, Ed.
What is it?
Well, you better see for yourself. I got a notion it isn't personal. You want to read it to me?
To whom it may concern. We have Ambassador Hasim in our power. The ransom was not paid. If it is refused us again, he will die. Also, the woman called Elizabeth Grant. Instructions will be sent through her phone how to deliver the $3 million. You will wait for them and comply, or all will be dead.
A fanatic.
Yeah, at this point, so am I.
Try and stay cool, Ed. I'm going to need it to deal with this kind of guy.
How do I know that Betsy's even alive anymore? I know in my gut Hasim isn't.
We don't know that for sure.
I could bet my bottom dollar. It's the way they work.
Well, we've got to let them give the lead.
Yeah, I guess.
Which still doesn't mean we can't make a few contingency plans of our own.
Yeah, but nothing that would put Betsy's life on the line.
Don't worry. She comes first. Well, second.
What do you mean, second?
First, we got to know what this Ahmed has in mind.
Are you quite comfortable, Miss Grant?
You know I'm not tied up like this. What are you trying to do?
I would not expect an unbeliever to understand what my aims are. But I know what I want. And you will do it or join Musahmed Hasim.
You mean you would kill me?
For our sacred cause and with the blessing of Allah, I shall use the sword to cut down anyone who stands in our path.
What is it that you want me to do?
I want you first to make clear to your policeman friend that the slightest attempt to try to controvert our instructions will mean your death.
If you're trying to get a ransom of $3 million, no one's going to pay that for me.
They will be paying it for Musahmed Hasim.
But he's dead.
We know that. No one else can be sure. We are going to make them be sure he is alive.
I don't understand.
You will, when we make the tape. And you will follow instructions to the letter, or you will regret it.
What do you expect me to do?
Very simply, to interview Musahmed Hasim, or what appears to be Hasim. You see, I have a hobby. I have made a tape of every word he has spoken at the UN and other places. By clipping these tapes and taking the words out of context as if answers to questions, they will serve my purpose. They will raise Hasim from the grave and win us money for the cause. So, we had better get to work, Miss Grant.
Far enough, Ed. Now, play it forward again.
Surely they want to be sure you're alive, Ambassador Hasim.
That I live must be obvious in spite of all the trials and tribulations in between.
Have you been mistreated in any way?
On the whole, I think, giving the wide gulf between opinions reasonably fairly.
But you wish to be free.
I beg, I implore my countrymen to rise to my aid.
Ed, you've heard Ambassador Hasim. I'm sure you can tell by his speech how alive he is. And I'm begging you for my life, too. I hope you can persuade the West Arabians to still pay the ransom for our exchange. Remember, when we were kids and you were always king of the hill? Well, never mind that. 1940, what was it? Six, I guess. It's so long ago. I hope you don't forget. Please, Ed, please get us out of this. The odds are 100 to 1 against us if you don't. The men who hold us mean business. Please, contact the West Arabians. Let them hear this tape and wait for the instructions.
Cut it off. Well, what do you think?
I think we contact the Arabs and go sit in Betsy's apartment with or without them for instructions. Yes?
This is Sergeant Ed Ritter.
Yes?
Do you have the ransom?
Yes, but how do I...
3 million as before?
Yes, but tell me how...
Here are your instructions. The money in a lightweight suitcase. Bills as before. You will place it tonight in a Central Park horse carriage, which will be waiting at the 72nd Street entrance. The driver has instructions to meander through the park. When we are ready and are sure the coast is clear, we will contact you to make the exchange. The money for the ambassador and the woman.
Now, just a minute.
Not even 10 seconds. We will not allow this call to be traced. Make your arrangements and wait for us to contact you again.
What do we do now?
Sit and wait again.
For what?
For the switch, the new drop. Oh, it'll be here any moment.
What do you mean?
Oh, face it, Ed. We have limited facilities, but we know the opposition always pulls a switch.
But we got them tapped now.
Oh, have we? What?
You want Ambassador Hassim in the woman? Deliver the money as I tell you and we free them. In the Bronx, there is a Milk Strong sign and below it an abandoned factory. Drop the money by the sign that says milk is for love and wholesomeness. When you do, Hassim and the woman will be set free.
Do we answer that or just wait?
Who knows? It's the old familiar pattern. We're trying to cover all the false alarms and pick the one that's for real.
Yeah. You know, I've been thinking about that.
Like how?
Well, you heard the tape. Anything about it bother you?
Well, sure, that was discussed. Hassim's voice on the tape sounded like it had been cut out of public speeches and made to sound like answers to questions made up after the questions were asked.
Yeah, that was my reaction, too.
So how does that help us?
Well, it seems like one big distraction to grab off the dough and run.
Yeah, that's how I feel.
Only worse than that, without any return.
All right, easy, kid.
Easy. When the girl I want to marry can be as dead as I think Hassim is long before we make the payoff? Unless we arrange our own.
Ed, how?
Well, I've been thinking about a lot of things. Remember on the tape, Betsy said, King of the Hill?
Yeah, sure, the old kid game.
Yeah, except when we played it, it was one special place.
Yeah, where?
Well, Betsy and me, we both came from the Washington Heights district. Now, there's a park there we used to hang around.
You mean near where the drop is supposed to?
No. Nowhere near there. Let me hear that tape again.
Sure.
It must be obvious, in spite of all the trials and tribulations in between.
Have you been mistreated in any way?
On the whole, I think, giving the wide gulf between opinions...
No, that's not the part I meant.
Yeah, well, where?
Run it fast forward a moment. Now.
Remember, when we were kids and you were always king of the hill? Well, never mind that. 1940, what was it? Six, I guess. It's so long ago. I hope you don't forget. Please, Ed, please get us out of this.
You know, that's been bothering me ever since I first heard it. She gave us a tip-off.
What do you mean?
King of the Hill. King of the Hill. That could only mean Fort Washington Avenue. And that malarkey about 46? Stop and think. 46 is 32 years ago. Betsy wasn't even born then. No, she slipped the fast one by the guys who were holding it.
Why?
Well, it's got to be a key for us.
What kind of key, Ed?
All right, let me see now. 1946 Fort Washington Avenue. King of the Hill. King. Sure, the park. Right opposite where we lived. The end of Fort Washington. The big apartment. That was the number. 1946. Jerry, that's where they're holding her. That's what she was trying to tell us.
You really think she sneaked that by them?
Yeah, sure. Hey, wait a minute. She did even more. Jerry, let me hear that tape again, huh?
Yeah, sure.
Let it run from where you cut it off.
Sure.
Please, Ed, please get us out of this. The odds are 100-1 against us if you don't. The men who hold us mean business.
All right, cut it. Please. That's it. That's the final clue. 100-1, apartment 101. That's where she's being held.
Do we try to beat the ransom rendezvous first?
And find Betsy dead like the ambassador, not on your life. So we take a chance, I figured it right. Hit the hideout before they can escape or hurt her.
Yes?
I have a telegram for a Mr. Ahmed Fatula.
For Ahmed Fatula.
Just hold it there, Ahmed. Don't move. You're covered 8 ways from nowhere.
You will not take me alive.
I warn you, you can't get out. Betsy, you all right?
Yeah, sure. Only what took you so long? Hey, where are you going, Ed? This isn't the way home.
That's right.
The Lincoln Tunnel leads straight out of New York.
That's right.
Well, where are we heading?
Anywhere will do. Elkton, Maryland, if there's nowhere closer, just so long as when we get back, we're married.
But we haven't told our families.
Well, they're just going to have to catch up.
It's kind of a rush.
Not after that last 24 hours. It's time, wouldn't you say, Betsy, that you had a permanent bodyguard?
And lived happily ever afterwards. I wonder if they ever changed their phone number, at least if it was Betsy's. But then, I doubt if it ever caused them such severe problems again. Except, do you imagine Betsy hesitates to answer it every time it rings? I'll be back shortly. Instrument you will ever own. It can bring you hope, joy, despair, frustration. It is your link with the rest of the world. It can be relief or agony, delight or frustration, fulfillment or disaster. Whatever it is there. A part of our lives we can neither ignore or deny. The telephone. Our communication with the stream of life. Our cast included Patricia Elliott, Larry Haynes, Ian Martin, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
I was trying to escape.
Run away?
If you want to call it that.
From home?
Swamp Man.
The who?
He lives at the bottom. Of the devil's cult. There are only holes where his eyes ought to be. And his hair is made of Spanish moss. His shoulders are knotted with muscles, and his hands can span a wagon wheel. He has no legs. Only a great long trunk with one huge foot like a giant clam that grips the rock at the bottom with a suction no one can break. And he lives on those who are foolish enough to walk the swamp by night. With his hands, he draws them down. Down beneath the green slime and shifting black sand.
Mrs. E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.